Morning everyone. Today I'll be presenting our recent work accepted at ICWSM, which is titled EmojiNet, an open service and API for emoji sense discovery. My other collaborators of this work are Lakshika, Dr. Shet, and Dr. Derek Brown. So before going into the details, let's see why we wanted to release this why we wanted to do this study. So as of now, the only emoji sense inventory we have is the previous EmojiNet version that we released, which covers 35% of all emojis supported by the Unicode consortium. And there the emoji definitions are directly coming from BabelNet, so the emoji sense definitions are very short. There we did not support platform-specific meanings of emojis, and it was not released as an open service or open data set. So those are the things that we wanted to address in this version. So what we did here was we extended our earlier version of EmojiNet so that it covers all emojis supported by the Unicode consortium, and we increased the number of sense definitions available in EmojiNet. Then for each emoji sense, we learned sense embeddings. I'll explain you what sense embeddings are in one of my later slides. We basically learned these sense embeddings from two corpora, Twitter and Google News Corp. Why we wanted to learn sense embedding versus support different studies like emoji sense disambiguation using EmojiNet. So we also wanted to support platforms specific emoji meanings in this version. So we selected 40, highly misunderstood emojis. Like, they are mostly confused across different platforms. So we selected 40 of them and ran an Amazon Mechanical Turk task to learn what are the platform specific meanings of those. And we released this resource as a new data set, and also we support REST API requests to browse and query the data set. Since you already know what EmojiNet is, I will explain it. So let me show you how we built this version. So in this version, we mainly utilize three openly available data sets. They are Unicode Consortium Emoji List, Emojipedia, and Emoji Dictionary. So here, the emoji Unicode Emoji List and Emojipedia, they list the Unicode definition or Unicode representation of an emoji. So to integrate the two resources, it was very easy. We just need to find the matching Unicode representation to integrate the two resources, the data extracted from the two resources. But to integrate Emoji Dictionary with the other two resources, it was a little challenging because the Emoji Dictionary does not list the Unicode representation of an emoji in its data set. So instead, it lists images of the emoji. So what we did was to link Emoji Dictionary with other two resources. We used an image processing algorithm based on image. So it was a nearest neighborhood based image processing algorithm. It was a simple algorithm, but it worked really well in our use case. I'll explain the accuracies we obtained in one of my later slides. So once we, in the first step, we link Emojipedia and the Unicode emoji list using their Unicode representations, and then in the second step, in the first step, we extract all the details from these two websites. So different images of emojis are also extracted in the first step. So then we do an image processing step here in step two. That is to identify a matching image for each image extracted from the emoji dictionary in that corpus that we extracted in step one. So by this time we know how these three resources should be integrated.
So let me just clarify. Yeah. So you have a collection of Unicode, and then each Unicode is associated with several images.
Yes.
And then each image has multiple sensors based on platform.
Yes. Yeah. So one Unicode can have multiple images based on platform. Then that image could be used differently in that particular platform, so it could have multiple meanings. So in this version, they are not dependent. They are platform dependent in this version, but it is only available for 40 images. But now we are working on, doing the same, repeating the same study for the whole 2,400 emojis we have. Actually, we have done that for 186 emojis or so for one of the upcoming papers. But so, yeah, it will be available very soon.
Then for this platform, you have a separate corpus.
What do you mean by separate?
For learning embeddings.
Oh, no. So to learn embeddings, So we are using the same Twitter corpus and same Google News corpus to learn embeddings. Based on the platform and the emoji, based on the platform, each emoji will have a different set of sensors. Basically, we are replacing each word.
Artificially made that corpus.
I did not.
I mean, you tune that corpus for each brand?
No. We are using the same corpus, our platform-specific sensors are not available online yet. Otherwise, I could have shown you how it works. I might be answer your question when I talk about how we learn platform-specific sensors. Train these embeddings. Basically, what we do is, let's say the definition of this emoji. Okay, so here's the sense definition. There could be multiple sense definitions, but this is what. Let's say, it says celebration hands. So let's assume for the moment these three are interpreted as prayer hands, but only this one is interpreted as celebration hands, right? By people. So in that case, we will associate this sense definition with this emoji, only with this emoji, and this is coming from Samsung. So this will be a Samsung platform specific sense, but will not be available for these three platforms. Probably this is coming from Apple, this one from Twitter, and this one from something else. I don't remember which platform this is coming from. So when learning the sense embeddings, what we do is we train a word embedding model using a Twitter corpus we have collected, which has around 110 million tweets. And then we replace each of these words in the sense definition using their most related 20 words. And we take, we create bag of word for this sense. So that is what we call the sense embedding here. So for a particular platform, we associate each and every sense with a particular platform.
That's my question.
Yeah.
So you had several settings. And for each setting, you replace the sense-dependent platform. That's right.
So, are you asking whether we collected separate tweet corpuses based on those platforms?
Separate. You have one single corpus.
Corpus, yes. Yeah.
And then you replace the sense of the two emojis separately for each platform.
Yes.
I and then you learn embedding.
No, embeddings are learned based on the
yes.
All the full corpus. Then platform specific sensors are learned later. Like they are basically they are learned by replacing each and every word by that one common embedding that we learn for the whole Twitter corpus.
Okay, so you are the union of all the sensors. Independent of
platform. So, platform-specific sensors are not integrated with each and every. Like, let's say Samsung has 5 sensors, but they are not collected into one single bag of word. They are listed as 5 different sensors because the purpose of this is to do is to support applications like emoji sense disambiguation. So, in that case. If you group them into one and expose it as a one big bag of word, it will not be that useful. So that's why.
The embedding that you learn is a union of all sensors, right? Because it basically looks at all the correlations.
It
captures the union.
It's based on the full Twitter corpus we have. So then we in step 3 we extract sense labels. So sense label is a word and a POS tag pair. So that is what we call a sense label. So Emoji Dictionary is a crowdsource website that lists sense labels for each and every emoji. So we extract them, and then in step 4,
aren't there any discrepancies that you find in terms of what you learn from your word embeddings as well as what people have, the crowdsource definitions?
Oh, there are a lot of noisy data in... No, Dr. Shet. So we did not learn new sensors from the embeddings. Embeddings are just a way of expanding these sense definitions so that they can better support real-world applications. There's another work that you can do sort of related to word sense induction. So you have a huge corpus. You look at what are the different senses you can learn for a particular word by looking at that corpus in an unsupervised way. So we did not do that here, but if we do that here and then we can I can comment on whether there are discrepancies in the senses entered by users versus senses learned by this corpus. That is not what we did. But there are a lot of noisy data in this resource, and you will see we had to remove around 35,000 or so sense labels because they were noisy.
So did you discriminate between actually senses in different post targets, or do you? Because I see that you wrote in it as a noun phrase.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. So basically, a word and its post tag is also recorded in this resource. So, if you say, if you search for the word celebrate or celebration, then you can also specify what post tag you are looking for. So yeah, we do capture that. Yeah, so once we extract the sense label, then we want to link them with the AppleNet. So that is what we do in step 4. So this is how we represent an emoji in our resource. So we currently have 9 tuple definition. So we store, you know, all the major things that we can extract from these resources, such as Unicode representation of an emoji, name, short word, definition, keywords. So these keywords are mainly introduced by the Unicode consortium to explain users how this particular emoji should be used. And different images that are available for a particular emoji across different platforms. And we also list related emojis. These are extracted from, currently these are extracted from Emojipedia, but soon we will be replacing with our own emoji similarity algorithm. We extract a category hierarchy for emojis as well from Unicode, and sense definitions are coming from that. So this is how we extract sense labels. So basically, we to extract sense definitions and to extract sense labels. Okay, let me go here first. So in this step, first we are going to extract these sense labels, and in the next step, we are going to associate these sense labels with their correct sense definitions. So I'm explaining this step now. We can extract sense labels from two resources. One is the Unicode Emoji List, and the other one is the Emoji Dictionary. In Unicode Emoji List, we only have keywords, but not post tags. POS tags are not available. So for that, what we did was, we extract the keywords first, and we generated the POS tags automatically. So there could be a lot of noise introduced in this step, and I'll discuss how we remove them. So for an example, for the keyword face, we will generate face noun, face verb, and face adjective, right? Because we wanted to have POS tags in our system. But in Emoji Dictionary, people have already provided these POS tags. So laugh noun, pig noun, and these are some of the sense labels that we extract from Emoji Dictionary. And we store these emoji sense labels in a temporary location. For the moment, we'll call this as a sense label pool. And then, now we know that we introduced some noisy data here in this step. And since these are, sense labels available in Emoji Dictionary are also human-generated, like crowdsourced data, there could be a lot of noisy data there as well. So we want to, filter out the noisy data. So we follow several steps to do that. So the first validation we do is to see whether a particular keyword and POS tag pair is a valid English word form. We can do that by querying BabelNet. So for an example, in this step, what we do is for each and every sense label in this sense label pool, we search BabelNet using that word and POS tag. If BabelNet does not list any meanings for that particular word, we assume that that is not a proper word in English language. So we remove it.
Actually, BabelNet is using BabelNet.
WordNet and many other resources, yes.
Yeah, but WordNet and Wikipedia.
WordNet, Wikipedia, Omega Wiki, like there are Wiktionary, there are a lot of.
I think the meaningful thesaurus that you can utilize for getting the meaning is WordNet rather than Wikipedia. My question is that. Two questions. First, in case that the sense contains more than one word.
Yeah.
And the second is that why you didn't bind to lemma of the word or the base form of the word and you just pulled all the actual variation of the.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good point, but we did not try. I mean, yes, the second point, we did not try the base forms One reason is you cannot search BubbleNet using the base forms. You have.
But by BubbleNet you can.
Yeah, but you know, if you look at the number of words in WordNet and BubbleNet, there's a huge difference because there are a lot of other words in BubbleNet that are not supported by WordNet. Yeah, that is something we can try, at least for the words in WordNet, but yeah, we did not try that here. What was your first question?
I create the content more than one
word. Oh, yeah, so in so that is what we will be doing in the word sense disambiguation step, the next step. So here what we are doing is whether a particular, we just want to see whether a particular word and PO stack there is actually used in English language. So our assumption is if it is, then it should be, there should be some meanings in BubbleNet. If it is not, then we think this word and PO stack there that we searched is not a valid.
For instance, a smiley face. So it's the sense of a smiley. So how do you handle face, the word face?
So in those cases, we use the whole phrase. Like there are, actually, I think for smiley face, there is a page in BubbleNet. So I remember for the term smiley, we had definitions in EmojiNet. So, if there are two words, I mean, mostly in this sense label pool, we do not have two word definitions. Mainly, they are like one word definitions. But if it is a phrase, I remember, you know, we had certain phrases as well. But phrases are very limited compared to the one-word definitions we have. So in this step, we removed all the sense labels that we generated, you know, which are not used in English language. Then we also noticed that there are some, in Emoji Dictionary, people list, you know, incorrect emoji meanings. So for an example, for face with tears of joy, a pig would be an incorrect emoji meaning. But that is, I mean, pig as a noun is a correct form of English usage. Like, we can use pig as a noun in English usage. Language. So, if those would not be filtered in this step. So, we had to do another filtration step where we would look at whether a particular sense label is actually, you know, relates to that particular emoji or not. So, that is what we do here. So, after this filtration, we remove most of the noisy data, and then we save those emoji sense labels to EmojiNet. So then, okay, so these are some of the numbers. So we had around 50,000 sense labels, and nearly 22,000 of them were incorrect according to English language. Like, they were filtered in this step. And then...
who put those labels initially?
So in Emoji Dictionary, it's a crowdsourced resource, so people go and put those labels. In Unicode, they only list the keywords, but they do not list the POS tag. But for us, we have to have the POS tags, so we automatically generate POS tags.
So the emoji list is very reliable, the Emoji Dictionary is not.
EmojiNet is reliable? What was your question?
No, emoji list keywords are reliable, Emoji Dictionary is not.
Emoji list.
Yeah, the emoji Unicode emoji list.
So yes, so these are reliable keywords, but the problem is they do not list the POS tags. So okay. We have to have that to link with the sense inventories. Yeah.
But what was your criteria for eliminating or determining that they're noise or incorrect?
So we use two steps. So here, the first one was now, if you look at this diagram, so for all the keywords listed here, we generate the POS tags, you know, automatically by a program. Right. Then, so BabelNet is like an English dictionary, which lists meanings for English words. So we assume that if a particular word and a POS tag pair, we assume that in BabelNet, if it does not contain English meanings for a word and a POS tag pair, then we assume that that particular word and POS tag combination is not a valid English use of that particular word. So that is one assumption we made.
So you add any POS tag to actually see term?
Yeah, so we are only limited for nouns, verbs and adjectives.
But you don't validate the sense, you just validate that this word exists, this meaning exists or not. I mean, but that word might have a couple of senses, yes?
Yes, so yeah, that is possible. So for an example, you would see face verb here,
yes.
Which is associated with face with tears of joy emoji.
Yes.
So in this step, we did that filtration. So even though a particular word POS tag pair has meanings, like a word POS tag pair that we generated has actual, you know, English meanings, but we in this step we check whether they are related to the emoji or not. So if not, we did not use it.
How do you check that it's
related? Me and Lakshika, we both did this. Oh yeah. This was manual. No. So in this first step, first validation step, we removed around 22,000 incorrect meanings, and then the remaining meanings, again around 15,500 were, you know, noisy data like this, so we had to remove them. So we ended up with nearly 13,000 sense labels that we wanted to do sense disambiguation in the next step. So this is how we did sense disambiguation. So basically in this step, what we wanted to do was to assign a sense label assign a sense definition to a sense label. So for that, we used an already available corpus called MASC. So this corpus is annotated with BabelNet sensors, and here we use two baselines. One is called the most frequent sense baseline. So what most frequent sense baseline is one where you calculate for each word, you calculate what could be the most frequent sense. What is the most frequent sense for a particular word based on a particular corpus? So for an example, in this case, in this corpus, let's say for the word happy, you have three senses, and you basically count the number of occurrences of each and every sense, and then you pick the highest number of the sense definitions that with highest number of counts, and assign it to the word happy as its correct sense. So that is what is called the most frequent sense. So we calculate the most frequent sense for all words in this MASC corpus, and if any of those words in MASC corpus is available in EmojiNet, then we assign the most frequent sense of that particular word to the sense label in EmojiNet and save it into the EmojiNet. If not, then we have to come up with another measure. So we define something called the most popular sense based on BabelNet sense definition. So in BabelNet, BubbleNet is created by integrating multiple resources. So for each word, there could be multiple sense definitions coming from multiple sources. So in most popular sense, what we calculated was for each and every word, how many senses BubbleNet lists. So we picked the most popular sense has the most number of senses coming from BubbleNet for each and every word. So if there's no match in this step, then for the other, for the rest of the words, we calculate the most popular sense using BubbleNet and assign the sense label for the most popular sense for that particular word and save it in EmojiNet. Okay, so when we do this step, we have done with assigning sense definitions to the sense label we have. So then here I show you how the emoji sense distribution looks like. So in our resource, this poop emoji has the most number of senses, which is around 55. Then this sweat emoji or teardrop. Towards the end of the tail, you will see a lot of newly introduced senses, so newly introduced emojis. One reason why these emojis are here is because they did not have a lot of keywords associated with them from Unicode consortium. And since they were recently introduced, they were not present in the emoji dictionary as well. Like, people have not started using them. So that's why we did not have much senses.
So is it natural to have a lot of senses? To me, this is a good situation to be in, right?
If there are a lot of senses for an emoji?
No, then it's bad, right?
Yeah, then it is difficult for us to,
Because I don't know what 55 senses actually mean.
Oh, mostly they are sort of related. So if you... If you go to EmojiNet... So most of these definitions are, related. They are like two different definitions, but same meaning. So.
But you could somehow aggregate the senses.
Yes, that we did not do here, but yeah, we can do that. So, yeah, these. Like, all these steps will affect, our emoji sense definition approach. Like,
so that means this frequency doesn't mean these senses are different.
Yeah, there are a lot of similar senses as well. So a sense is different here if it has a different sense label. Right? So that is what is... So here it is noun, these two are the same. We evaluated how well the image processing approach that we used to integrate the three resources and the word sense disambiguation approach we used to integrate to link sense labels with sense definitions. So the image processing approach, even though it was simple, it performed really well. We had 96% accuracy. That is mainly because the images are very simple the algorithm we use happen to work well with, if you look at emojis, they are basically very simple images with one or mostly two color variations. So this algorithm works really well with such cases. So that's why the accuracy is very high. And for the word sense disambiguation step, so these are the noun, verb, and adjective distributions. The two baseline approaches that we use, most frequent sense baseline and most popular sense baseline, were able to correctly identify around 10,800 sense labels, correctly assign meanings to 10,800 labels, and it failed 2,125 instances. But we then manually corrected these instances so that our resource is correct, you know, because we won't use the resource in.
I don't know, from your example, it feels as though that the way you're using the word sense is sort of different from how I think about it.
Okay.
I mean, it feels as though lots of words or senses as you use it, they are all synonymous in English. And so they should kind of be elevated to the next level. So there may be three distinct meanings, and then within each meaning you'll have 10 words associated with them.
Right, so what you are saying is similar
I mean,
to word next in
the six words that you showed me, right?
Yeah,
to me, they all fall into the same
right.
Overall. I'll differentiate between, let's say, the poop versus chocolate, but
yeah,
within
yeah,
that, you
right.
have so many equivalent ones.
So we do not have a concept equivalent to word net synsets in this resource. If we had that, I mean, that is something we can work
yeah,
on.
To me, that seems very natural.
Yeah. So then those sensors would be, you know, clustered together. I mean, that is something we can do.
Yeah.
But in this version, we did not introduce any concept like that. Even in BabelNet, there's one concept called BabelNet synset. But yeah, that is something we can work on.
Some of the actually
emojis with low frequency might jump up as a very high frequency in number of senses. Because I'm sure that one of those emoji in bottom had more senses rather than those. Well, I mean, that is possible, but still, the things you show at the very bottom of the image had bottom of that chart had only like one sense, because they had only one keyword
one
coming.
Keyword.
Yeah.
Yeah, but also for example, love emojis.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, the ordering could be changed. Yeah. So. Yeah, then to support different applications using EmojiNet, we trained some word embedding, you know, two word embedding. Well, we trained one word embedding model and used one existing word embedding model. So we collected tweets that has emojis in them for a period of 1.5 months. And we removed all the retweets and collected around 110 million tweets with emoji, and then using Word2Vec, we trained one word embedding models using the tweets, and we also used the Google News word embedding models, which is available publicly. So the idea is to see whether so in natural language processing applications, it is shown that when you have when you want to use tools built on well-formed text for in social media related research, the performance you would not get the same performance as it is in as it is with the well-formed text. So that's why we wanted to use two different word embedding models and extend our sense definitions using the sense embeddings learned from these models, so that EmojiNet can be used with well-formed text if you want, as well as social media text. Because you will see emojis in emails, and you will see emojis in social media posts as well.
So
and we want to support both.
Want to make a Google model, that model, or Twitter corpus?
Yes, we train the Wordtwig model for a Twitter corpus, and we use the Google News embedding model, which is available publicly. So those are the two word embedding models that we use. No.
The same model, what do I use?
No, the training corpus is different.
Ah, you use the training corpus as well.
Yes, so for the Twitter word embedding model, the training corpus is tweets.
So you run also on the corpus?
I'm sorry, what?
I mean, you run also on the corpus?
No. So the Twitter corpus is something we collected. But Google News corpus is something which is not available for us, as far as I know. So instead, they give us the word embeddings, the trained word embeddings.
So for each emoji, they have actually a vector.
So here, yes. So that
Google
is what
Google
actually
gives you. That.
No. Google does not. Google does not have emojis.
Okay.
So what?
So then, how do you get this?
So what we learn are basically word embeddings.
Then word embeddings for the keywords or other things associated with that emoji.
Yes.
Okay.
Then each word is replaced by their 20 most related words. So that's how we explain.
I think there might be a big bias.
In which one?
Because you very roughly replace emojis with the meaning. I mean, their meaning has more context than in the Google corpus.
You mean the embeddings learn from...
So for instance, for a smiley, okay? You replace the emoji of a smiley, you got the vector of a smiley from Kuya corpus, and also you learn that embedding from your own.
Yes,
corpus,
yes,
okay?
Yes, yeah.
So, but you cannot claim that these two...
They are not the same.
They are not the same.
They are not the same, yeah. So, we do not... use as they are the same, they are exposed as two different embedding models, and they are, I mean, in even in the resource, Google based emoji sense expansions are provided separately, and Twitter based emoji expansions are provided separately, and in both our applications we have used them separately. Yeah, so based on the three context words we have, so what I mean by context words are basically these. For each sense, you have a set of words. So BabbleNet context words are directly coming from these words. In Twitter-based context words, each of these words is replaced by their 20 most related words, and Google News-based context is again the same, but with Google News words. Okay, so we also wanted to add platform-specific sensors to our resource. So for that, we set up an Emerson Mechanical Turk task where we, presented Emerson Mechanical Turk users an emoji and a sense label, and we asked them whether that is a correct sense label for that particular emoji or not. It's a yes-no sort of question, and they also had to write down why they think that whether that's a correct sense or incorrect sense for that particular emoji. So, as I said, we did this for 40 commonly misunderstood emojis. 25 of them are coming from past work, and 15 we added by ourselves.
How is it related to platform specific?
How is...
How did you
choose? We did not tell them that this is what we want to do. We basically wanted to see whether they we showed them platform specific images. So okay.
All of them.
For the 40 40 emojis, we had around 6,200 or so sensors, but with different platform specific meanings, we had around 13,200 or so, you know, individual tasks. No, not 6,000 sensors. It was less than that. But yeah, that is what we did. So different platforms. So so for an example, there should be celebrating noun associated with celebration noun sense label associated with each and every image, and they are shown to the people, and they would see, they would tell us which image associated with that particular sense label. So that is what we do.
So maybe you can add one of your questions as a sample in the slides.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. I can do that.
So when you say commonly misunderstood emoji, that means that for the same emoji, they how do you know that it's misunderstood? They may mean differently, right? They just say that it's sarcasm or ironically, like, I just put a smiley face but crying.
Yeah.
Like, how do you know that it's misunderstood, it's intended meaning?
So 25 of them are coming from a previous study where they looked at you know, those emojis and showed that they are interpreted differently in different platforms. And then for the remaining 15, we looked at the rest of the emojis and we were basically looking at like, we already had the earlier version of EmojiNet, so we had an idea of how people are using certain emojis, which was not covered in that earlier 25, you know, earlier list of 25 emojis. And we also looked at how different those emojis look in different platforms and whether those differences could have resulted, you know, whether those differences have resulted in any particular emoji meaning in our earlier version of emoji.
So that means it's not like they misunderstood, like who misunderstood. Right. So it's maybe like that's the intended meaning. So I think like it shouldn't be like misunderstood, but like one emoji may have different meanings.
Yeah, that is actually what we meant, but yeah, I should not use that terminology in that case.
Yeah.
Yeah, so then you know, after the creation of the resource and you know, explaining how we evaluated the resource, the track also needed us to show some use cases of the resource. So for that, we selected the two applications, emoji sense disambiguation and emoji similarity. So again, for this one, we selected the 25 emojis that were presented in, you know, that was referred in the past study I referred, which was from Hannah Miller from University of Minnesota. So we took the 25 emojis, and for each emoji, we randomly selected 50 tweets, and we manually annotated what could be the meaning of that particular emoji in that tweet, and then we ran a very simple algorithm called simplified less to understand to identify the meaning of that particular emoji in a tweet. So based on the three context words we generated, we noticed that Twitter based context words are, you know, better at this particular task, which sort of proves the fact that tools built for well-formed text does not work well with social media text, because we were using this particular application on a social media text corpus. Actually, the sense well, context vectors that we extracted from Twitter-based context, you know, in our Twitter, using our Twitter corpus actually performed well.
Some of these accuracies look extremely low. What does it even mean?
Task is very difficult, so that is one thing. Should you use
more people for trying to
so we should use we should see if you look at the way we selected the tweets, they are basically like we selected tweets randomly. So if you look at these studies, they carefully select their training set. We did not create training set in this case, but the validation set we created collected randomly.
Okay, I have a different tag on this. Yeah. So what is the average number of sensors for each of the images that you are showing, each of the emoji that you are showing? Because if it is, let's say, 6 sensors per image, right?
Yeah.
Then 1 out of 6 may be correct and the other 5 will be wrong.
Yeah. That is...
But 18% means there is no, it's just a random thing.
It's basically intrinsic in the fact that it is used in so many different ways. Yeah.
So I do not have that statistic here in this slide, but I can certainly discuss that.
The way maybe to argue is that if a particular thing is legitimately used in 6 different ways, then the accuracy will be low by its very nature, right?
Right. So since we did not have sense grouping for most, like these are like very commonly used emojis, so they had a lot of meanings in our emoji sense dictionary as well. So that could have affected the results, but I think more than that, I would say we basically wanted to provide initial results. Since this was a dataset track paper, they needed us to show how the resource could be used in another application.
So could you evaluate it in the following way? Yeah. So for each emoji, let's say there are a collection of, let's say, so for the first emoji, you have 6 sensors. So if you get 1 of those 6 sensors, then you give yourself 100% score. So will that make a big difference in the way the table looks? Because there are 6 meanings, so if you get 1 of them, then you're 100% right.
Oh, so...
Not understanding what you're saying.
I see your point. So basically, if we want to, let's say, disambiguate the sense of this particular emoji, then we would be only looking at the sensors for that particular emoji only. Like, we are not looking at the other sensors.
No, for that emoji, there are 6 sensors.
Yeah.
Now, in the tweet, you annotated with 1 sense. If one of the sensors that you annotated is 1 of the 6,
yes.
Then do you give yourself 100%?
And if my algorithm can find the same thing, yeah, then
if it finds one of them, then it's 100%.
No. In my tweet, I have annotated this emoji as okay. This in this particular tweet, it has the second sense out of the 6.
Okay.
Then in my algorithm, it should find the same sense. So when I run that tweet in my algorithm, then it should find the same second sense. Otherwise, it's not correct. Like, I do not calculate the ordering of, like, I do not use ranks. Like, we can calculate the rank and say, okay, we have 6 sensors, and the correct sense is the second one, but in this list, in the list of the 6 senses, the correct sense actually comes as the second sense, but not the first sense. I do not consider that. If it is coming in as the second most possible sense, but still it is. Yes.
It's like a puzzle, it's a kind of binary, precision at that position?
No, no, we did not do that. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, if it is correct, it's correct. If not, no. Yeah.
So the babble-based, Twitter-based, and news-based, what you're referring there is the basically the word-to-vec model was trained
bag
by
of words. No, no, no. For the first one, there's no word-to-vec model.
Okay.
These are those are basically sense definitions extracted from BabbleNet, and the bag of words generated from the sense definitions from BabbleNet.
Okay.
But the in the Twitter-based context, each and every word in that BabbleNet bag of words are replaced by the 20 most related words learned from the word to model. So
okay.
These are three bags of
Twitter.
Yes.
Trained by Twitter.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And
in
Google
second
News.
Case,
yeah.
In third case,
it is Google
trained
News.
By the Google News.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I think that it's pretty obvious that if you have trained your word to vec based on tweets, yeah, you'll get better accuracy when you are trying to compute it on.
Yeah.
On
so, yes,
but it's good to know, yeah.
So like these results make sense
yeah.
Because I mean this is how it should be actually.
Exactly.
It sort of follows with what others have already published in NLP research. With others findings as well, and at the same time. We could also show that like these are the improvements that we made in this version which were not available in the previous version, so we could also argue that these improvements are actually required for this tool to be used in practical applications. So yeah,
so we should be using a Twitter-based word-to-vec trained model
if you want to use
social
media stuff. Yeah. So we also wanted to try how this resource could be used for emoji similarity tasks. For that, we extracted use one data set called Emo350. So it is a data set that has 50 emoji pairs that represent 100 different emojis. 50 pairs but 100 emojis. And then we wanted to create a graph based on the emoji similarity. So here we represented a node in the graph as. So we represented an emoji as a node in the graph, and if the same meaning or sense label has been shared by two emojis, we link the two emojis using an edge, and then we use label propagation algorithm to find clusters in the graph. So this is the graph that we came up with for the 100 emojis available in this particular data set. These are some of the emoji clusters we could find. So you could see one island here that sort of represents sports and entertainment. Like we came up with these labels. This graph is created based on how the sense definition, sense labels are shared across these emojis. So then we also, it does not look good here. So in another experiment, we also used how we can use an already existing semantic similarity measure to calculate emoji similarity. So for here, we use Jacquard similarity as the semantic similarity, emoji similarity method measure. What it does is for the two emojis, it would look how many different meanings this emoji has versus how many different meanings this emoji has, and how many meanings are shared across them divided by the union of the that's all we did. And thank you very much for your time. And if you have questions, you can.